And he will present on the complexity of simulating probabilistic time graph transformation system. That's a who work with Matthias Balkowski, Maria Maxiova, and Holger Giese. Please, Christian.
All right. Thanks for the introduction. And after you already read out my introductory slide, we can dive right in. In this talk, I want to first introduce very briefly probabilistic time graph transformation systems and our running example, then motivate why we should care about simulation and about complexity, present our simulation algorithm, which we actually first introduced at last year's ICDT, and then for the main part, go into the worst case complexity analysis, and finally also show some empirical result that confirm our theoretical findings from this work. So to start with probabilistic time graph transformation systems, they were first presented at ICDT 4 years ago and are a high-level description language for real-time systems of systems, which supports structure dynamics, time behavior, and probabilistic behavior. Our example for these is the RailCAP system, a system of autonomous shuttles driving on a track system. So we have this track topology, which are just static nodes. We have shuttles that are moving with real-time constraints. These real-time constraints basically just say, okay, how long can one shuttle stay on a track so that they're actually moving and not just standing, so that we have this movement ensured with regards to time. And we have connections that might fail. So there we have this probabilistic behavior in our example. We can use probabilistic time graph transformation system basically for cyber physical systems, safety critical systems, for verification at design time. That is our use case that we are looking at. And when we first introduced PTGTS, that was before my time in this research group, they were presented with a model checking approach, which allowed model checking of such systems, but only limited for small models. So we had models like this, where we have like one shuttle on a track and another shuttle on another track, and these tracks merge. So we have a junction here, and then we could compute the likelihood, the probability of these shuttles crashing or being able to form a connection or avoiding each other or performing an emergency brake. So we could simulate these, but we were limited to small models of, say, 50 nodes. Didn't go much larger with our model checking since we evaluated the whole state space. However, we wanted to look at larger examples. For example, this is a graph for the tram network of the city of Potsdam, where our university is. And we modeled it with some 3,000 nodes. And for this, of course, our model checking approach wasn't usable anymore. And that's why we introduced our simulator for probabilistic time graph transformation systems. Of course, we cannot do real verification, but we can do validation on these real world systems. And we might also find some conflict. So maybe this junction or crossroad or this constellation, which we didn't think of before with our model checking, but where errors occur. So we have this chance to import real world topologies and find new problematic constellations. However, Potsdam is a rather small city and tram networks are rather small isolated networks. So we wanted to look at larger examples. This is something we didn't yet model as a graph for our topology, the S-Bahn network of Berlin, you might recognize it. And to model it with our system, we would need something like 100,000 nodes or more, which we weren't so sure how our systems performed. And that's why we wanted to look at the scalability of our simulation algorithm. How well does it scale for larger topologies? So basically, to sum it up, we have this small area where we can solve or where we can work with model checking. We have this large area that is covered by simulation to some degree, of course. And we don't know how well it scales and where this boundary is, where even simulation maybe it doesn't work anymore. And for this, we have, and this leads us to our research questions for this paper, which is to formally establish a worst case complexity, to identify and resolve scalability bottlenecks, and to also identify possible input restrictions. So maybe we can be efficient and scalable, but not for all kinds of graphs. With that, let's briefly look at our simulator architecture. It consists of three components. One is this graph importer that imports topologies from Open Railway Map and creates an initial graph out of them. Then we have our rule importer that takes the graph transformation, a probabilistic time graph transformation system modeled in Henshin, and transforms that into special simple graph transformation rules that we can use for our simulation. We presented this step in detail in our last paper at last year's ICGT. And then finally, the simulation engine, which handles the algorithm. And I now want to go through this algorithm step by step, very briefly. In the first step, of course, we load our model, which we will work on. And then we have to find all patterns that occur in this model and add markers for them. So in this example, we have one invariant marker with an upper bound. So this invariant has a time bound, which we have to compare against this global time. And we know that this invariant must always be true. So this invariant can only be here until the time 4 is reached. And before that, it must be removed or in some way be obsolete. We also have one drive rule, which is a shuttle with two empty tracks ahead of it. So the shuttle can drive, it's a mode drive. It also has some time constraints. And yeah, we probably have a lot of other patterns here where the dots are on the sides and where this graph continues. In the second step of our algorithm, we want to select one marker and apply one rule. We are in a simulation, so we apply rules one by one. And for this selection, we have a special data structure, which considers the time. We have in this data structure all our markers, so invariant markers and rule markers, and their time constraints. And so since we know that all invariants must be fulfilled, we know that the next rule application must be somewhere in the time between the current global time and between the smallest invariants that we have, so somewhere in this interval. And the only rule that we find in this interval is our rule R1, which has this lower bound. And so we know that it must take place between this lower bound and the upper bound posed by the invariant somewhere here. We randomly select a new time for our simulation. We adapt the global simulation time, and we can get out of our data structure and actually apply this graph transformation rule. So this shuttle can move forward. We change this part of the graph. Now, we also have to perform a clock reset because this clock is reset by this graph transformation rule, the probabilistic time graph transformation rule. It's now reset to this global time. Then in the third step, we have to incrementally update all our markers. In this case, we have to check and update the existing markers. In this case, our invariant marker, we see, of course, is not valid anymore because it refers to a shuttle and to a track where the shuttle is not standing on. So we can remove it. We might also just update the upper and lower time bounds of these markers, not in this example. Then we also have to find any new markers. So we find a new invariant marker, which we initialize with new time bounds. We find a new drive rule marker because we assume there's a new free track here on the side so that our driving can continue. And with that, our algorithm repeats and we can always perform this loop of simulation steps. Now, let's briefly look at what we expect for scalability. For this initial find phase, we have a lot of graph transformations. We have to find all possible matches. And so since we have a big model and we have to search all of it, we assume that it scales linearly with the model size. So we hope that it scales linearly. It probably won't be any better, but that's what we expect at this point. For the simulation step, we hope that these graph transformations remain local, so restricted to this affected subgraph, and that thereby we might be able to do it in constant time. However, we have this selection of a marker. And since I already told you that for this selection of a marker to apply, we have to consider, for example, all invariants. All invariants must be fulfilled. We have some global aspect that we have to consider in each simulation step. And this will be what we'll look at most. But first, let's look at these input properties or some assumptions on our input graphs for our topologies. With the host graph, of course, we have a number of nodes, but we also consider a special subset of nodes, the so-called active nodes. We mean that as interacting subsystems in our systems of systems graph. And formally, we can define it that these active nodes are so that are a selection of node types, so that each left-hand side contains at least one of these active nodes. In our example, that would be shuttles, and typically these number of active nodes is much smaller than the size of the overall graph. For example, I showed you the map of Potsdam, which we modeled with 3,000 nodes, the track topology, but Potsdam only has 50 trams. So we have much lower numbers here. And so it hopefully we can use this N active instead of N for a lot of our scalability questions. Also, we have a constant number of edge types and a constant upper bound for the node degree for the number of incoming and outgoing edges. This, of course, restricts us a lot, so we cannot model any broadcast messages maybe or any network communication that is really widespread. But on the other hand, it makes sense to have this limit for if we look at geographic topologies, because if you look outside, you might have two-way junctions, three-way junctions, four-way junctions, but not 20-way junctions. Or even if you have, you don't have N-way junctions. But we have a constant upper bound for the number of junctions. And in practice, most of these values are very small. So we assume a constant upper bound for our node degrees. With regard to the probabilistic time graph transformation rules, we assume that all left-hand side patterns are weakly connected. Weakly connected means that they are connected if we disregard the direction of the edges. So if all were undirected, then they would all be connected. You could reach everything from everywhere. Our implementation allows the backwards navigation of edges. So we have an index for backward navigation. So weakly connected is enough for us. We also assume that there is a constant upper bound for the next nesting depth of all nested application conditions. So we don't have infinite nesting, which would be a problem for us. We also assume that nobody sneaks in any very complicated operations on computations on the attribute side, just to be on the safe side there, because there could be a very complex computation there. And also, we assume that successive rule applications cannot increase the number of active nodes. This is important because if some rule can just spawn new active nodes, we can't really use this N active as our complexity bound. And this might seem like a rather strong restriction, but we can still model a lot of scenarios if we have a pool of elements, a maximum pool of elements, just no infinite growth. We need a pool of active elements, and then we can work with that and use that at our limit. So, let's briefly look at the graph pattern matching cost. I think with these in the paper, we have a very thorough argumentation on how expensive our graph pattern operations are. I will briefly summarize it here before we go to our data structure, which is more interesting. For this initial find phase, we have to select. We can iterate all active nodes. Our tool supports that. And from each, we have, with this constant upper bound to the node degree, a bounded search. So in the end, we just, this initial find scales in O of N active. Scales in O of N active. For the simulation step, we have, we know that our affected subgraph has a constant size because we have a constant amount of rules. We have limited nesting, and each rule might increase the affected subgraph, but only by a constant factor. So in the end, this affected subgraph is constant. And in this affected subgraph, we can only start a constant number of searches. And we already know that our search patterns are bounded by this node degree. So we can perform them all computationally in O of one, so in constant time. Now let's get to the data structure, which is more interesting. We know that in this data structure, we have O of N active invariant and rule markers. And in each step, you randomly have to select one rule marker that respects all invariants and that by itself is enabled at the current simulation time. Let's start with the invariants. Invariants can only have an upper bound. We argue in our paper why lower invariant bounds can be represented in a different way, so we don't lose any expressiveness by that. And with this limitation to upper bounds, we simply have to find the smallest of these upper bounds. And for that, our idea is to use a balanced binary tree. We implemented that with an AVL tree that stores all these invariants we have ordered by the upper bounds. And we just need to find the smallest one, which is our I1 here and here. And since we know that we have O of n active number of invariants in this data structure, and since an AVL tree has a logarithmic selection, insertion, and deletion, we know that all our operations here are in logarithmic time. Now, with that, we know in which interval between the current time and the smallest invariant the next rule can occur, and we need to find one rule whose interval between upper and lower bound overlaps with this interval that we have here. So we need to find this invariant interval overlap, which is a lot more complicated. And for rules, we cannot just discard the upper or lower bound completely. We need both on a formal side. So our idea here is to split the problem in two parts. We use only the lower bound for selection, and we use the upper bound for maintenance. So after each step, we remove any bounds where any rules where the upper bound has passed, because they are deprecated, but we don't use it for selection. So we can just use two different balanced binary trees with logarithmic access to manage this. So first, looking at the lower bounds for the selection, we just have balanced binary tree. And in this tree, now that we know that we need to find anything that is below 4, which is our smallest invariant, we have to find any of the nodes here. Note that this one doesn't have a negative time value, but it has a none value, a null value for the time, because we might also have nodes that have no invariant at all, but they still, of course, can also be selected. So we have to randomly select any of these. It's a bit complicated. We had to manually or implement our own AVL tree implementation for that, because we had to do a special selection step, because we want a fair non-deterministic selection. So we can't just say, okay, 50% chance of going left or right, but we have to calculate how many they are. And as you see, if we traverse down the tree, we might have some elements that are outside our search area, but that are still down here. So even if we store how many elements are down there on one path, we still have to recompute that and adjust it by once traversing this boundary between the search area, between what's inside and outside of the search array, because there might be a lot of jumping back and forth along the line. With that, we can do a fair non-deterministic selection of our elements, and then I have a maximum size of, and again, with a maximum size of O of n active, we can do this random selection in logarithmic time. We have to traverse this tree multiple times to go down here and up here again, and then randomly down to some place until we selected our node. But it's still possible without a problem in logarithmic time with three traversals of this tree. And insertion and deletion, again, is in logarithmic time. Now, we come to the second aspect, because now that we selected a node here, R1, and we advanced our simulation time, we might get into the situation where we have some rules with upper bounds, and these upper bounds are passed are below the current simulation time, so they need to be disabled. And we cannot search this binary tree for it, because in this binary tree it's ordered by the lower bounds, and the lower bounds of these might be just anywhere. So we cannot refer to these lower bounds for that. That's why we have a second binary tree for the upper bounds with only those elements that actually have an upper bound. And we can use this to easily identify all elements with an upper bound that is lower than our current simulation time. And then we can remove these elements also from here and there, because here on the element nodes, we store also the lower bounds, and we can use these lower bounds then to traverse this tree and find them and remove them. So we can remove them, but you might already have noticed the problem here. We it might be possible that we have to do multiple removals in one step. In the worst case, maybe we have to remove all the nodes or all the elements from our tree in one step. And then, of course, this single step isn't logarithmically. For that, we use an amortization argument. So we argue that if we have to remove a lot of elements in one step, then in the next steps, we have a fewer elements to remove, fewer elements that have to be removed. So the next steps get cheaper. And also the previous steps where these elements have not been removed are cheaper for that. So if we have a minimum number of simulation steps, then on average, we still have a logarithmic runtime. So to sum it up, for our initial find, we add some O of N active markers with a logarithmic cost each. And for the simulation step, we randomly select a marker in logarithmic time. We add a constant number of markers or remove or update them also in logarithmic time. And finally, we have to disable markers also individually in logarithmic time, but we might have to remove multiple, but these costs are amortized if we have at least as many steps as our N active, which is also a reasonable assumption because if N active are our number of shuttles, then maybe each shuttle should have moved at least once for our simulation to be called reasonably complete. To combine these two results for the initial find, we have graph transformation and bookkeeping, and together it's in O of N active times log N active. And for our simulation step, we come to a logarithmic effort on average, of course, if we have enough steps amortized. So this is very important that this is only an amortized complexity results and that individual steps might be more expensive. But for simulation, we want to look at the end result and not at the individual steps. We don't care so much about the individual steps if they are more expensive. Before I close this talk, we have a very short empirical evaluation. We generated some random graphs. We also tested our new data structures on our realistic examples from the last papers and saw that they performed well there. But for this, we also wanted some very large examples, which we don't yet have with realistic topologies. So up to 500,000 active nodes, 500,000 shuttles in our system. And for the graph transformation effort, we could see there that this initial find scales as expected linearly. Notice that both scales here are logarithmic. And that the graph transformations in the individual steps, we ran it for 10,000 simulation steps each. So that the curve isn't so small down here. We ran it for 10,000 simulation steps each, and we see that there's almost a constant time, and we are pretty close to explaining why these effects here have to do more with our implementation and with caching effects and garbage collection and whatnot. Also, we tested our data structure and compared a naive implementation with a simple list, which grows linearly, and our AVL bookkeeping, which grows logarithmically for all of it. And we see that the graph transformations, of course, are by far more expensive than this bookkeeping, even though the bookkeeping is a global component here and the graph transformations are the local component. But we need a very large example for the bookkeeping effort to outgrow the graph transformations. So we are pretty confident or pretty happy with our results. So to sum it up, we presented our simulation algorithm with an improved data structure. So this one was new in this paper. We formally established a logarithmic worst time complexity, amortized and with some restrictions on the graphs, but which we also argue are reasonable. And we did some experiments that confirm these results. And in the future, we want to improve our tool support, go into distributed simulation, because if we have these really large systems that we want to simulate, it makes sense to maybe look at how we can partition it better and also consider some extensions of the PTGTS formalism, one of which you saw today in the first talk of this session already. And we have a lot of interesting ideas how we can improve the expressiveness of this formalism. Okay, thanks for your attention. Sorry that I needed 1 minute longer. And I'm looking forward for your questions. Thanks.